here. So we're going to just do something to help take us further in this atmosphere. Would you grab the hand of the person next to you? And just tell them, let's go forward together. And as you're holding their hand, I want you to begin to lift them in prayer. Is that all right? Let's just cover that individual and then just help us to pray for this atmosphere and this environment. Did anybody come expecting anything from the Lord? That's a little weak. Is there anyone in the house who's expecting the Lord to do something tonight? Well, let's begin to pray. Come on, you pray. Father, we thank you. We honor you. We exalt you. As the songwriter has said, we will exalt you because you are God. There is no one like you. God, many of us have searched and we found that there is nothing like you. For those of us that need healing, you're the healer. For those of us that need deliverance, God, you're the deliverer. For those of us that need salvation, you're the one that paid the price so that we can have eternal life. We will exalt you. And Father, we make a commitment tonight to follow you, to follow you forward. You're the one who's gonna take us everywhere that we need to go. And God, if we follow you, we will not fail. We will not fail. Father, we pray for the individuals whose hands we're holding tonight. We pray, God, for their expectation to rise. We pray for their faith to rise in this atmosphere. We pray, God, that you do great and mighty things in them, even as they have come and gathered in this place. God, you know them intimately. Your word says that the hairs on their head, you have numbered. So you know exactly what they need. And we thank you, God, that you said that where two or three are gathered and they are touching anything, you will give it unto us. So, Father, we're praying for the individual whose hand we're holding tonight. Give them all that they need. You are the sustainer. You are the keeper. God, give them everything that they need. Your word says that you're the God that can do exceedingly abundantly above all that we could ever ask, think, or imagine. Father, do it for them. Do it for them. Do it for them tonight. I pray, God, that they don't leave this atmosphere the same. I pray, God, that you mark them in this space in the name of Jesus. God, claim your territory. I pray, God, that you're lifted in this atmosphere and that you draw all of us to you. Be the life change that we need. Be the transformation that we need. Jesus, we speak your name in this atmosphere. Jesus, from the pulpit to the door, we speak your name in this atmosphere. Jesus, and somebody call him with me. Jesus, 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 Jesus. We thank you that at your name, demons still tremble and flee. We thank you, God, that at your name, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that you are Lord, to the glory of God who is our Father. We thank you, God. We thank you for saturating this place. Thank you for your anointing that rests in here already. We thank you, God, because of the expectancy that has risen in this place. And we know that we will see you, God, perform a mighty work. And we will go forward in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Colette Butler.
My name is Aurea Fowlero.
My name is Joanna Clark.
And we are your moderators for this evening's service. In Psalm 122 and verse 1, David writes, "I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord." Anybody glad to be in the house of the Lord this evening? Anybody glad to be in the house of the Lord this evening? Give your God a shout of praise. Hallelujah! 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 Listen, you could have been anywhere else this evening, but you chose to be in the house of the Lord, especially our young people. And this evening, I believe that the Lord is going to move in a way that we have not experienced before. And so I want to encourage you this evening to just take your expectancy level just a little bit higher than it was when you walked through these doors. And so we've been worshiping all week and celebrating since Wednesday under the theme, Go Forward. And this evening, the National Youth Ministries worships under the sub-theme, Moving Forward Together. I want you to look at your neighbor and say, we are moving forward together. I want you just to take a moment. And could you imagine how the story regarding the exodus of the Israelites from Egypt would have turned out in the face of difficulty and fearfulness if they went back to Egypt and served the Egyptians? But here it is, Moses, he reminds them saying, do not be afraid. Stand firm and you will see the deliverance the Lord will bring you today. Then further along in the text, Moses says, the Lord will fight for you. You need only to be still. And thereafter, as Moses cries to God, he tells them to instruct the Israelites to go forward. Or another text says to move on. You see, sometimes what we see in the natural, in spite of God's promises and his instructions, it causes us to become stagnant and we freeze up, and sometimes we cower in fear. But I just want to encourage someone this evening under the sound of my voice that to move forward in the face of difficulty. For the Bible says in Deuteronomy 31 and 6, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid and do not panic before them. For the Lord your God will personally go ahead of you. He will neither fail you nor abandon you. As you move forward when you see now doesn't look like what has been promised, because Hebrews 11 and 1 says, now faith is the confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. Move forward even when temptations, young people, and prayer pressure rises, and don't give in. For 1 Corinthians 10 and 13 says, no temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. And God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will also provide a way out of escape so that you can endure it. Move forward in the direction that God is leading you. Move forward even if you have to stand alone. Move forward in faith and in obedience unto the Lord. And let's move forward together in the body of Christ, being in one mind and one heart. This is my encouragement to you today, for the Lord is with you. And so as we continue in worship this evening, I'm going to ask our youth praise team to bring our opening song. And immediately after, we're going to have declarations by Bradley Oliver and Jessica McKinney in that order. Be blessed.
Good night, church. If you are excited to be in the house of the Lord, if you have an expectation to see the Lord lifted up tonight, why don't you stand on your feet and join us as we sing this song tonight. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. I want to see you. Anybody want to see the Lord tonight? Father, we want to see you lifted. Be lifted, Jesus. Hallelujah. Oh, yeah. Shine.
This is the generation of them that will seek your face. And Father, we didn't come tonight for flesh to get any glory, but we came tonight from you, God, to magnify the name of our Father. So Father, tonight we don't extend to you our hand, but we extend to you our lives to come now and purify our hearts. And in an atmosphere like this, let a revival of holiness take place tonight, God. We need a fresh fire tonight, God. Come now, Holy Spirit, and captivate our hearts and captivate our minds, and let fire from heaven begin to fall and consume everything that does not look like you. Spirit of the living God, we give you permission tonight to fill us
with your power. We command the glory of the Lord to begin to descend and begin to fill this room. And we command the heavens to open and the angels of the Lord to begin to ascend and descend and bring the glory of the Lord in this room, that healing will take place and deliverance will take place. Manifest your power tonight, oh God. Send your fire. Send your fire. Send your fire. Send your fire. Lion of Judah, roar in this place. Lion of Judah, roar in this place. By your power and your might, we receive you tonight, Father. This is an atmosphere where your sons and your daughters come tonight to receive from you. Let the power of God begin to fill this room. Come on and let a desperate cry be released. Father, we're hungry tonight. We're desperate tonight. Oh, God. Send your rain tonight. Send your rain tonight. Come on, do I have any worshipers in the building tonight? We're returning to the heart of worship, where it has nothing to do with me. Nothing to do with me. Nothing to do with me, but everything to do with you. I call you Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Shalom. I call you my healer. I call you my deliverer. I call you my strong tower. I call you my way maker. I call you the wheel in the middle of the wheel. I call you Almighty God. I call you Abba Father. You are not a God that is deaf, but you can heal. You are not a statue that can't feel, but you can. You are not a God that does not respond. But tonight, I call upon the God that answers by fire to come and sweep through this sanctuary and let the glory of the Lord be. Come on. Come on. Somebody's fire. Come on. Release your glory. Release your glory, Estanaya. Release your glory tonight. Oh God. Oh God. Oh God. Father, this atmosphere has been prepared for you to come and wreck us tonight. Wreck us tonight. We didn't come to watch a show tonight, but we came to lay before the presence of the living God. Our God is not dead, but tonight I declare that he's alive in this place. He's alive in this place, and he's moving by his power and by his might. Do your work in us tonight, Father. Do your work in me tonight, Father. Strip us in your presence, Father. Strip us in your presence, Father, that we may look just like you. We surrender. Have your way. Almighty God, is there anybody in the room that just wants him to have his way? I just want you to have your way. I came in here with some stuff on me tonight, but I want you to have your way in me, mighty God. Yes, sir.
In Philippians 3, 13 and 14, the Apostle Paul encourages us with these words. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling Jesus. In our faith walk as young Christians, let us listen to Paul's advice and keep an eye on the future. We should let go of the weight of our mistakes, of our failures, and of our regrets from the past, and keep our eyes on the road ahead. Because of Christ, we are called to life with purpose, meaning, and lasting value. We should not stop moving forward in our spiritual journey or get comfortable. Instead, we should be determined and persistent, knowing that God has a plan and a reason for each of us. Let's honestly seek His will and believe that He will lead and provide for us as we bravely go into the future He has planned for us. Therefore, I declare that we are fearfully and wonderfully made, crafted by the hands of a loving God with a divine purpose and destiny. I declare that the chains of bondage are broken off the feet and hands of our youths, that they are now free to worship, free to sing, free to dance, free to glorify and magnify the Lord, free to exalt the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I declare that we are more than conquerors through Christ who strengthened us, empowered by His Spirit to overcome every obstacle and every challenge that comes our way. I declare that no weapon formed against us shall prosper, and every tongue that rises against us shall, hallelujah, hallelujah, shall be condemned. I declare that we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, set apart to proclaim the praises of Him who called us out of darkness into His marvelous light. I declare that we will trust in the Lord with all our hearts, not leaning not to our own understanding, acknowledging Him in all our ways, knowing that He will direct our paths. I declare that we will be strong and courageous, not afraid or discouraged, for the Lord our God is with us wherever we go. I declare that we will meditate on God's word day and night, hiding it into our hearts, that we may not sin against Him and that we may be successful in all that we do. I declare that we will love the Lord with all our hearts, with all our souls, with all our minds, with all our strength, that we will love our neighbors as ourselves. I declare that we will be a light in the darkness, a vessel of God's love and grace, shining brightly for all to see, pointing others to the hope found in Jesus Christ. I declare that we will honor our parents, respect those in authority, and live a life of integrity and righteousness, seeking first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and everything else shall be added unto us. I declare that we will not conform to the patterns of this world, but we will be transformed by the renewing of our minds, that we may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. In faith and confidence, I proclaim these declarations over our nations, over our lives, and the lives of our youths throughout the length and breadth of the Bahama Islands and throughout the world, believing that God will fulfill every promise He has made, and that His word will not return. void. Why? Because he is not slack concerning his promise. So my church, so my church people, so keep pressing, keep moving, keep going forward in the name of the Father, and in the name of the Son, and in the name of the Holy Spirit. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, oh neighbor, keep pressing, keep going forward, keep moving forward in Jesus' name. Amen.
We will now have a song done by the voices of worship, all the way from Exuma.
Thank you. give them a big round of applause all the way from Mixnomo.
I will be content in every circumstance. You are Jireh. You are enough. The scripture reads, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. And that was indeed a joyful noise that we just heard.
Are y'all glad to be in the house of the Lord tonight?
Amen. Amen. I know that those melodious voices just got me excited and ready to praise the Lord. Please stand to your feet as we welcome the scripture reading by Monet Sims, followed by Keisha Hall, who will formally welcome all visitors.
Good evening, church. The scripture lesson is taken from Exodus chapter 14, verses 5 through 15, and it reads, and it was told the king of Egypt that the people fled, and the heart of Pharaoh and his servants was turned against the people. And they said, why have we done this, that we have let Israel go from serving us? And he made ready his chariot and took his people with him. And he took 600 chosen chariots and all the chariots of Egypt and captains over every one of them. And the Lord hardened the heart of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and he pursued after the children of Israel. And the children of Israel went out with an high hand. But the Egyptians pursued after them, all the horses and chariots of Pharaoh, and his horsemen and his army, and overtook them, encamping by the sea, beside Pihahiroth, before Baal Zephon. And when Pharaoh drew nigh, the children of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians marched after them, and they were sore afraid. And the children of Israel cried out unto the Lord. And they said unto Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Wherefore hast thou dealt thus with us to carry us forth out of Egypt? Is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone that we may serve the Egyptians? For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. And Moses said unto the people, fear ye not, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will shew you today. For the Egyptians whom ye have seen today, ye shall see them again no more forever. The Lord shall fight for you, and he shall hold your peace. And the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel, that they go forward. And I'll read the last verse again. And the Lord said unto Moses, wherefore criest thou unto me? Speak unto the children of Israel, that they go forward. The word of the Lord is already blessed.
Good night, everyone. My name is Keisha Gomez Hall, the youth leader of the great Church of God of Prophecy, Meadow Street. It's an honor to be with you here tonight. Welcome to the youth night of the 2024 Conclave under the invigorating theme, Moving Forward Together. This gathering promises to ignite inspiration and propel us toward greater momentous occasion. If you are thrilled to be a part of this occasion tonight, shout praise the Lord.
Praise
shout praise the Lord.
Praise
let's embark on this journey of growth, unity, and empowerment together. We extend a warm greeting to our distinguished National Bishop, Dr. Franklin Ferguson and Dr. Romina Ferguson, the General Presbyter, Chant Bishop Clayton Martin and his beautiful wife, and the Presiding Bishop, Bishop Tim Coulter and his beautiful wife. And to all the esteemed bishops, pastors, and national workers, and to the vibrant youth of our church. Tonight, we are going to break protocol with a twist. Turn to your neighbor and ask them, are you ready? Say it again, louder. As the musicians set the mood, here is your mission. Young and old can participate, doesn't matter. What I want you to do, I have three things I want you to do. The first thing, you need a cell phone, okay? Make sure you have a cell phone. The first thing I want you to do is snap a selfie. Now, don't go yet. Wait till I say all of the instructions, okay? First thing, snap a selfie with a youth from another church, not your church. Another church, and you have to make sure and tell me their name and the church they go to. The second thing I need to do is to snap a selfie with a senior member in the congregation. Okay, senior. Now you know youths stop at 40, so I need 40 and up, okay? And the third thing I need you to do is snap a selfie with your dedicated youth leader. Pray they're here tonight. Okay, are you ready? Now, the twist is you only have 5 minutes to do this. Some people should have get started. If you finish, you finish. Hurry up, my 5 minutes. It's 8 o'clock. It's 8 o'clock. You have till 8:05. My next friend here was third. But I thank you for all the rest of you who are participated. God is going to truly bless you. Because I don't have enough gifts to give to all of you. So thank you for participating. What church do you go to?
Ministry.
Big ups to Ministry. Thank you for participating. What church do you go to?
San Salvador.
All the way from San Salvador. Thank you for participating. What church do you go to?
I go to Anglican.
Woo! Anglican in the building. My friend who came fifth. What church do you go to?
I go to the great Soldier Road.
Thank you. The great. Come right after Meadow Street. My humble friend that came forth. What church do you go to? Sister Tara? Okay. Third. Let me see these pictures. So if I could call my fifth and sixth. Mm-hmm. She got it. Big up. So I'm guessing you're from Soldier Road. Yes. From the second great church of Soldier Road. Thank you, my friend. And what's your name?
Romaya Tullock.
Romaya Tullock, thank you for coming tonight and participating. My second. And I'm guessing this is from the second great church, Soldier Road. And what is your name, friend?
Ivana McKenzie.
Good job, Ivana McKenzie. Here's your wonderful gift. And thank you for participating. What? And I know what church you go to. The third great church, Marshall Road. And what is your name?
My name is Ariana Wilson.
Ariana Wilson.
2024. Good evening. Are you happy to be in the house of the Lord? It's a new day. Are we not? Did we come to praise God? If you are in the Lord, let me say, oh yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah. I'm just so happy that when they did that little game, that nobody came to take a picture with me for a person so over 40. So I want to mark myself safe in the presence of all of you, safe from a selfie for a person over 40 in the house tonight. But I greet all of you tonight in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I acknowledge the presence of our presiding bishop and his wife, Bishop Clayton Martin, and his wife, and Sister Roe White. I don't call Sister Roe Dr. Roe because she fills all kinds of spaces for me, but Dr. Sister Roe. I also acknowledge the presence of all of our bishops, our zone district supervisors, our district supervisors, our pastors, our national workers, our youth leaders. Also recognize the presence of our speaker, Brother Adams, and his lovely wife, and of course, Minister Chad, and all of our newly appointed bishops, one of which is my pastor. Oh yeah, oh yeah, oh yeah. But I just want to establish protocol because Keitra didn't get the memo, but my Blue Hill Road is perhaps, and that's all I gotta say. Y'all know what comes next. But can we just give a praise to our mighty God? Can we just stand to our feet and give God a praise? Had it not been for the Lord who was on our side, where would we be? Turn to somebody and say, I have tasted and I have seen that the Lord is good. I don't want to take up time. Be seated. My report tonight is going to be brief because I know there is a word from the Lord in the house. And I just want to say and want to invite the youth leaders, if you are here tonight, to come and join me. You know who you are, all of the youth leaders. My report, Bishop Franken, to this conclave is not on behalf of myself, but it is on behalf of all of the youth leaders through the Commonwealth of the Bahamas tonight. Tonight I stand on the established protocol and I honor my husband, Gavardo Thompson. He is a quiet giant. He is a prayer warrior. Can I tell you that he just say one prayer and I said, yes, I'll marry you. I honor my children, Ilea Thompson and Israel, who's over there in the band. I honor my church family, my extended family, my friends, and if you don't know who my church family is, I'ma just say it again, my Blue Hill Road. We have been moving forward. This group of young people together with my family and their family and friends and their pastors and those of them who couldn't come but who are watching throughout the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, we've been moving forward from March 2023. Our goal as ambassadors for Christ was to represent Jesus, one, educate and equip young people, three, accommodate reconciliation, four, disciple others. Have we done that, team? We give a report tonight to say that over the past year, we have hosted four national youth leaders meeting, two district meetings, one in New Providence and one in Grand Bahama, countless subcommittee meetings. We have visited Grand Bahama three times. We have visited Eleuthera one time. We have visited Harbor Island one time. We have visited Andrus one time. We have visited the great Exuma one time. And presiding bishop, in case it wasn't obvious, I'm from the island of Exuma. Together, this great team, we have done much. Together, through the support of you, family, and friends, We started out by first going to Grand Bahama in April. Then in May, we hosted and participated in Global Serve Weekend. Not only did we serve in Global Serve Weekend, we also supported the National Youth Camp Ministries in July 2023, and in August, we supported International Youth Day. We supported Bishop Woodley Thompson and Brother Antonio Hanna last year in CLC when we participated in the community initiative. Thank you, Bishop. In September 2023, we hosted our first annual youth leaders retreat on the small little island called Paradise Island. October last year, youth from around the Bahamas, in fact, more than 50 youth from around the Bahamas came to New Providence to celebrate with us for our annual National Conclave Conference, Youth Conference, sorry. We also joined the Ministry of Youth, Sports, and Culture in their celebration of Youth Month and participated in the National Youth March. In October, we also participated and had the opportunity to host an event that was joined by many called Ask Me Anything, which brought together leaders in various sectors of our community at a round table so that our youth can ask them anything. A part of our National Youth Convention in 2023, we officially launched the Legacy Awards. Is this church a church with a great legacy? After the Legacy Awards, we had a praise party. And after the praise party, we had a time of powerful ministry led by none other than Madison Colley. In November, we rested. And in December, we rested again. But then in January, we partnered with My Blue Will Road and hosted a prayer booth at a health and wellness walkathon. In February, we moved into our much anticipated youth revival. I come here with a report tonight. The church is in good hands. The future of this church is in good hands. Because I have seen young people, teenagers, willingly say yes and preach and declare the word of God. I've seen it in New Providence. I've seen it in Grand Bahama. I've seen it in Inagua. I've seen it in Exuma. I've seen it in Andres. I've seen it in Eleuthera and Harbor Island. Church of God of Prophecy, we are moving forward together. And earlier this month, we celebrated a few of our youth leaders who are all under the age of 40 under the theme of International Women's Day. As I take my seat, I want you to give this round of people a round of applause. These are the faces of just some of the hard workers. Tahila Forbes works in any capacity. Daria works in any capacity. Crystal Maycock is my boss. I work for her. She works in every capacity. Madison Colley, minister at large, works in every capacity. Dawn Colley, minister, works in every capacity. Miss Strawn, Michelle Strawn, give it up all the way from Pinewood. She is willing to work in any capacity. We have Ashley Stubbs in the back there, flew all the way from Atlanta to be with us tonight, willing to travel and serve in any capacity. We have Keitra Gomez, public relations extraordinaire. I just want Sister Pauline to know that I could resign today because Keitra is more than ready to go forward and do what she has to do. How about Sister Colette Butler? Give it up for her. We have also Sister Ferguson. Give it up for Deontay. All the way from Andrews, ain't nothing in Andrews more. This is the second island I'm from, and this is Andrews. Give it up for Jessica McKinney. Holly Roll, all the way from Gambia. Latika, formerly from Eleuthera, but now at the Love Center, and all the way, this lady should need no introduction. She is our longest serving youth leader, all the way from San Salvador. Give it up for Pastor Lana Fernanda. And I don't see on this stage some others who helped: Catherine, Barnaby, Ashley, and Anton, who helped with the praise team, Patron. But can I tell you, I stand because this team does the work, and this team is not afraid to lead. I want to also acknowledge our former national youth directors, none other than Brandira, Ministers Brandira and Jason Woodside. As I take my seat, I want you to stand with me one last time. Do you believe we serve a mighty God? Do you believe we serve a mighty, mighty, mighty God? Do you have confidence that He is able to take us through? Do you believe that we are going to move forward together? Do you believe that there is a word in the house tonight? Do you believe that God is going to bless some young person tonight? If you believe that tonight, I just want you to worship with our worship team as they just lead us into a time of celebration for what God has done thus far, but also what God will do. Put your hands together and let's worship with our worship team.
Hallelujah. We serve a big God. Anybody believe that we serve a big God? Hallelujah.
I have a very big God. Very big God.
Given the task of introducing our esteemed, longest-serving youth leader. This is Pastor Lana Fernando. She is the longest-serving youth leader in the Church of God of Prophecy. She will now come with some encouraging words to move us forward together, to which she will be followed immediately by the Wolf Road Dance and Mind Ministry. Let's give a round of applause, please. Night Conclave 2024.
Told those young people, they're making me a little bit nervous. To God be the glory. Great things He has done. I stand on the established protocol. I want to share with you this evening three strategies we as the church and youth leaders should follow to move forward together. A few years ago, when Bishop Timothy Johnson and Minister Deanne Johnson were the National Youth Directors, I brought a team down from San Salvador, about 12 to 14 young people, to youth conference. At that time, the name was Generation Powerful. One of those nights, we stayed up until about 2-3 o'clock in the morning. And I sat and I listened to those young people talk. And I tell you, I was in awe. And I said to them, I will never look at you ever again and judge you, because you have a story. Throughout my years in ministry, a multitude of young people have passed through my hands, all from different families and environmental backgrounds, much like the one I started with. I have heard countless other stories from my young people. Some have brought me to tears and completely changed my perspective. I have been in youth ministry for more than 30 years. And through this, God has taught me so much. I have a passion for the ministry,
And that has been one of the things that has kept me for so long. While passion may serve as a driving force, it can only sustain you for so long. Galatians 6 and 9 says, "Let us not become weary in doing good. For at the proper time, we will reap a harvest if we do not give up." In Matthew 9, 37 through 38 says, "Then he said to his disciples, 'The harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest.' Tonight, I will briefly cover three strategies we as laborers should have for the harvest moving forward. Number one is simply prayer. As a believer, prayer offers us access to divine wisdom and guidance. James chapter 1 and 5 says, "If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given unto him." Prayer builds character and renews strength. Isaiah 40 and 31 says, "But they that wait upon the Lord, he shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint." Secondly, young people, youth, leaders, walk with patience, empathy, and understanding. I know sometimes it can be frustrating. Some Friday nights, I would have 30 to 40 plus young people, and it can become overwhelming. I remember one of those nights, I told them not to come back. And sure enough, next Friday, they were back in those benches. This shows me that they are hungry and seeking for someone to talk to and to connect with, someone to relate to and to confide in. As young leaders, it is crucial to remember that we will encounter children from a wide array of homes and environments, and we cannot treat them as a product of their environment, but rather image bearers of the God, that we claim we serve and love. This ministry calls us to walk in the fruits of the Spirit. Hallelujah. As you serve your church and your community, I heard Bishop Ferguson said on Wednesday night during his address that this work is not for the faint at heart. This is not for the jelly back. Amen. Thirdly, maintain the image of Christ. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 11 and 1, "Imitate me as I imitate Christ." It is important for not just believers, but especially for Christian leadership to maintain a godly standard. These young people watched you, not just within the four walls, but they watched every encounter you have with others and with them. Be the same person you are on a Sunday morning like you would be on a Friday night. Seeing this consistent character shows that you are authentic and trustworthy. It leads them to not just respect you, but also to trust you. The youth of this nation is our hope for the future. We control the outcome of our future by what we put into our youth today. Moving forward, ask yourself these three questions. What seeds am I sowing in the lives of our young people around me? Am I upholding the standard of Christ? Am I creating a safe place for our young people to feel, to be felt, to be heard, to be seen and understood as we move forward? Amen. Let us govern ourselves accordingly. God bless you.
To declare to you, my past is over. I'm in you. Things are made new. Surrendered my life to Christ. I'm moving, moving forward. Oh, yeah. What a moment. Brought me to such a freedom, Lord. I have found in you, you're the healer who makes all things new. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm not going back, I'm moving ahead. Here to declare to you, my past is over. Moving forward.
We will now have the offering by Bishop Julian Newman. Bishop Julian Johnson.
That's all right, buddy. That's all right. That's all right. That's all right. Come on, let's give him a chair. That's all right. We are with you. Amen, amen. Come on, let's give the youth a round of applause. They are moving forward. Come on, give them a better chair than that. They are moving forward. Come on, give them a better chair than that. They are moving forward. Amen, amen. God bless you, Dr. Gyandi. The youth is in a good place. And they are going forward with the rest of the church. The scripture in Exodus chapter 14, verses 13 says, "And Moses said unto the people, Fear ye not, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will shew to you today." The word that I want to, or the section of this verse that I want to get to your attention, is that God said to us, fear not. Look at someone and say, fear not. Fear not. There's no need to fear as it relates to going forward. The Lord God is with us. The second point I want to make with you is the second part that said, stand still. The amplified version that connects with the Hebrew writing says to us that this concept of standing still, it says to take your stand. Look at someone, say, take your stand. Take your stand. Be firm, be confident, and undismayed. And these are the examples that we would have seen here tonight so far with this youth that are gathering. Give them another round of applause. Now we want to collect an offering tonight. And I want us to bless this youth. Look at someone, say, let's bless the youth tonight. We are going forward and we want to plant a seed as it relates to where we are going. We don't fully have all the answers, but we want God to be in the equation as we plant a seed. Amen? Tonight I'm going to ask a few persons to join me. We want to give $50. That's from me. Apparently, my sons are working now, and I told them that's what daddy can give. So y'all give y'all part, and they send $100. Amen. I'm glad they're working. I'm glad they're working. I want some of the parents that are here tonight and those that we would have sold into to bring me $50. Come, give me $50 tonight. Thank you, Bishop. Yeah, I want to hold that phrase. Thank you. Amen. Come on, come on, come on. Give me $50. Don't have me waiting long. Give me 50. Thank you, Bishop. Thank you. 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 I see Trevor in the back there, my son in the Lord. Trevor, I'll take your $50 now. Come bring it when you come. God bless you. You're not a parent, but
You're my son. God bless you. Oh, thank you, Bishop Coulter. We do take American currency likewise. Yes. God bless you. God bless. Come on up. Come on up. We want to sow into these young persons tonight. We want God to know as we go forward, we want God to know that he is going to bless, that he is going to cover our young persons as they... Thank you, Bishop. God bless you. God bless. Yes, yes. That American will do too, sir. Thank you. Yes. God bless you, Bishop. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Bishop Hannah and Bishop Nat. God bless you. Bishop Knowles, God bless you. God bless you. Come a few more. A few more. One or two more. Amen. 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 Okay. Now we want the young persons to come. Oh, we have Pastor. Come, Pastor. Come. Come. I'll wait on you. Yeah. Amen. God has been so good to this youth ministry. Bishop Coulter, Bishop Martin, Bishop Ferguson. We are thankful for where God has our youth positioned. They are standing firm. Come on, let's give the Lord a round of applause. Now we want you to come. Please come up. The youth, can you give us some music? Can you give us? Okay. They're going to give us, the youth bands are going to give us some music. And I want you to come up and I want you to give willingly to the work of the Lord within the youth that we see before us as they move forward with us going within the ministry. Youth band, crank it up. Please stand. Please come. Let us give to the Lord. Ah, yes. Yes, yes. Hallelujah. Let us give to the Lord. Ah, yes. Music with spirit. Let us have it, you man. Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yes, yes, yes. Oh, yeah. Yes. Come on, stand to your feet. Let's worship the Lord. Come on, stand to your feet. Let's worship with the youth of the nation. Oh, yes. Play that music. Oh, yes. Oh. What a feeling, what a feeling. Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Oh. Yes. Yeah. Oh, yes. Oh, glory. Yes. Oh, yeah. Oh, glory. Come on, let's give the youth band a round of applause. We don't want you to get tired now because we want you on the march tomorrow. Amen. Amen. Just before we go, before you pray for the offering. Tonight and for the past two nights, you would have received an envelope that says National Bishop Touch of Love Offering. Now here's what I need you to understand. Bishop Ferguson, this is his last conclave. This is his last opportunity for you to put something into this envelope, okay? Now, it has here, please give a minimum of $100. Do what you can. But I want you to put your name on it. Huh? What? We need envelopes, Bishop. We need envelopes. We need envelopes. Okay? Please give a minimum of 100. And I'm so glad that Bishop Coulter and Bishop Martin have set the pace. We take American currency in this envelope likewise. Amen? Put your name. We're going to document the names that have been given so Bishop Ferguson can have an idea of persons who would have sowed into his ministry. Let's give him a round of applause. He has done so well. Come on, let's give Bishop Ferguson, our national bishop, a round of applause. God bless you, Bishop Ferguson. We love you. And you can be assured that the Johnson family We'll put a wonderful offering in here for you. Let's bow our heads. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, tonight. We give you praise. We give you glory. We give you honor, Lord, for the youth that have gathered here from around all of Bahama Islands to celebrate you. They have expressed, O God, an understanding of what it is to go forward. So we give you praise. We thank you, Lord, for all those who gave and all those who would have wanted to give. That your kingdom, O God, will forever be blessed. Help us, O God, as a church, as you prepare us to go forward. In the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit. And everyone say, amen. God bless you. Let us continue to enjoy tonight's service. Amen.
Amen. And I just have a brief announcement to make. And this is from the caterers. All of those persons, particularly the Family Island and Grand Bahama delegates, if you're eating tomorrow from the cafeteria, they are asking you to place your order early so that when you come, it is partly prepared. They simply need to put in one or two pieces so that you don't have to be here a long time after the service, because we want you to be on time for the parade tomorrow. So go in there early, give them your name, let them know what you want. When you come back, they hope to have it all stacked up and ready to give to you. Is that okay? Is that okay? And finally, 6 a.m. prayer meeting tomorrow morning is going to be conducted by Bishop Woodley and myself. And we are asking as many of you, particularly you young persons, to come out tomorrow morning for 6 o'clock. And let's have 1 hour of praying and seeking the face of the Lord. Amen. God bless you.
Good evening, church. It's a pleasure to be here to give a small token of appreciation to Sister Coulter. So a brief idea of what this is me and my team, we did a program with the Small Business Development Center, and we had to develop a product in their boot camp, right? And what we came up with is a product called Sip and John Canoe. So this is a small crafting kit where you can make a small John Canoe piece. We have a gombe soda and various things to paste your own small kit, and along with the instructional video, if you scan this code. So we just wanted to give you a taste of the Bahamas to take with you, to do by yourself or with someone else.
Thank you very much.
So that's the stage.
I love it.
Photo. Yeah.
Who do I hug? Huh? Who do I hug?
Oh, yeah, I suppose me. Yes.
Thank you.
Bless the Lord. Stand to your feet. Stand to your feet. Our praise and worship team, they are ready. And as we prepare our hearts for the word, they are here. And the next voice you will hear after will be that of our speaker, Minister Christopher Adams, who hails all the way from the Church of God of Prophecy, Healing and Transformation Center, Freeport, Grand Bahama. All right, we got Freeport, Grand Bahama in the house. He is married to the lovely who is right here in front of us, and together they have one son named Xavier. Minister Christopher Adams is an anointed man who loves the Lord. Let's continue in worship and remain prayerful.
Bless the name of the Lord. I need you to turn to your neighbors on each side of you and say, come on, let's exalt the name together. Come on, just nudge them, push them, grab them, tell them, let us exalt the name of the Lord together. I can't do it by myself. I need you to help me. Come on, the Bible declares, let's exalt the name of the Lord together. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is what? He's good. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord because he's what? He's a good God. And so we are going to declare that in this place tonight, that our God is good and he has done us well. Come on, put your hands together. Come on, put your hands on it, yes. Oh, my God. God is good. than me well, oh my soul. Rise up and pray that God is good. Oh my soul, rise up and pray that God is good. Yes,
He has done me well.
Oh my soul, let me lift your head again.
God is good.
Oh my soul, rise up and pray. God is good. Rise up and praise. God is good, yes. Oh, God. Come on, let's lift it up. Oh, and the walls, they will. Tumbling down, tumbling down. And the walls, oh, yes, they will. As we begin, oh, say it again. And the walls, they will. Tumbling down, yes, they will. For us, see what a mighty God He is. See what the Lord has done for us. See, somebody help me say and say, see.
See what the Lord has done for us.
Oh, take a look and see.
See what a mighty God He is.
You ought to see this.
See what the Lord has done for us.
See what a mighty God He is.
One more time.
See what the Lord.
See what the Lord has done for us.
Oh, He's been good. He's been mighty, mighty good.
See what a mighty God.
Oh,
God.
That's what the walls are tumbling.
Tumbling.
I can see it.
Tumbling.
I can feel it.
Tumbling.
Oh, yes, they are. The walls are tumbling.
Tumbling.
Yes, they are. Yes, they are. The walls are tumbling.
Tumbling.
As you worship, as you pray.
Down,
oh, yes, Jesus. The water
tumbling
as you worship, as you pray.
Down,
oh, so we say glory, glory, Lord. Yes, we give you glory, Lord. Glory, glory, Lord. You are a mighty God. Can you declare that today? Oh, glory.
Glory, glory, Lord.
We give you glory, Jesus.
We give you glory, Lord.
Say glory.
You are a mighty God.
You are a mighty God.
You are a mighty God.
Somebody call on the name of Jesus. Like you know him. Like you've experienced him. Like never before. Come on, let's call on the name. Whoa, say Jesus. Jesus. Call his name. Call his name. Stand and proclaim. No other name. Stand and proclaim. No other name. But Jesus. 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 We love to call you. We love to call you. We love to call you. Oh, you are a mighty God.
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 You are a mighty God. Can we call the name of Jesus one more time? Oh, say Jesus. The name,
Jesus.
But that name,
Jesus.
No other name,
Jesus.
But that name,
Jesus.
I can search to the east,
Jesus.
And to the west,
Jesus.
To the north,
Jesus.
And to the south,
Jesus.
Nobody like him,
Jesus.
Nobody greater,
Jesus.
Stronger,
Jesus.
And wiser,
Jesus.
Only that name,
Jesus.
Can put me out,
Jesus.
Of my mess,
Jesus.
I can save my soul,
Jesus.
Make me whole,
Jesus.
The women sees. They obey that name,
Jesus.
The winner sees
Jesus.
Mountains power,
Jesus.
Mountains move,
Jesus.
When we call
Jesus.
Upon that name,
Jesus,
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 Jesus.
Show up in this place,
Jesus,
Jesus,
Jesus. God. You are a mighty God.
You are a mighty God.
You are a mighty God.
You are a mighty God.
You are a mighty.
You are a mighty God. Come on, if you can declare that he's mighty in this place, if you experience how mighty he is, if you've experienced how awesome he is, if you've experienced how good, 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 good the Lord has been to you. Come on, can you just go out and worship him in your own way? Yeah, yes. Oh, my God. Oh, my King. Oh, my Lord. Over everything. God, you reign. You reign supreme. We love to call you. Yeah, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Come on, somebody bless him in this place.
Hallelujah.
Come on, somebody bless him in this place. Like you've encountered Jesus before.
Hallelujah.
Come on, bless him in this place.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
So we love to call on the name of Jesus. He is our healer. He is our provider. He's a way maker. He's our deliverer. He's a strong tower. If you think of all the things that he's been for you, hallelujah, you go out and worship him right now for who he is. For who he is. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Just take a moment to worship him. To worship him. We love your name, Jesus. Song says, call the name of Jesus. He is our healer. Call the name of Jesus. He is our provider. Call the name of Jesus. He's our protector, oh my God, oh
our deliverer. Nobody greater. You're like a fortress, Jesus. We can run into you. We got Jesus. There's no name that's greater, that's stronger, that's like a God. No name that's greater, that's stronger. I need you to call upon the name of Jesus. Oh. Yes, Jesus. Yes, Jesus. Yes, Lord. Come on, fire. Whoa. Whoa. It works. I tried the Lord, so I can say that name heals all. That name delivers all. It works. It works. It works. Come on, then you can testify that. Say that name. I can tell you that, oh, that name The name of Jesus. When we call on the name, the atmosphere has to change. Our situation changes in our favor. Everything he does, it works in our favor. When we call on the name, when we call on your name, can you just take a moment to just call on the name of Jesus? Jesus, Jesus, put Jesus in your situation, put Jesus in your problems. Put Jesus in your trials. Put Jesus in your obstacles. And I guarantee you that you will win. Yes, you will.
Take a few seconds to begin to magnify the name of our God. For the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and we are safe. Any righteous people in the room? Any righteous people in the room? Isn't he worthy? Isn't he worthy to be praised? Isn't he worthy to be adored? If you believe that tonight, take 10 seconds and just adore. Let him know you love him. Let him know you appreciate him. If you believe he's worthy, we serve a matchless king. We serve a matchless king. Something incredible is about to happen in this house tonight. For I see that the waters are already troubled in this house tonight. And you don't have to wait on a word from me. If you need to dip in quickly, you could take a moment right now and get whatever you need from the Lord. For he is in this room to do a work. We don't serve a lazy God. He's here to do a work. Fill my cup, Lord. I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirst, sting of my soul. Hallelujah. Sing it as a prayer. I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Say bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Here's my cup, fill it up and make me whole. Hallelujah. Numbers, the 13th chapter, beginning at verse 26 through verse 30. Numbers, the 13th chapter, beginning at verse 26. To verse 30. And it reads, and they returned from searching of the land after 40 days. And they went and came to Moses and to Aaron and all the congregation of the children of Israel unto the wilderness of Paran to Kadesh, and brought back word unto them and unto all the congregation, and showed them the fruit of the land. And they told him and said, we came unto the land whither thou sent us, and surely it flows with milk and honey, and this is the fruit of it. Nevertheless, the people be strong that dwell in the land, and the cities are walled and very great. Moreover, we saw the children of Anak there. The Amalekites dwell in the land of the south, and the Hittites and the Jebusites, and the Amorites dwell in the mountains, and the Canaanites dwell by the sea and by the coast of Jordan. Last verse. And Caleb still the people before Moses and said, let us go up
at once and possess it. For we are well able to overcome it. Emphasis on this part, at once. For we are well able to overcome it. For a brief moment, I want to preach to you from the topic, it is time to move forward. You may be seated. For a sub-theme, I would like to use, it was only a matter of time. First, I would like to give honor to our presiding bishop, the person of Bishop Timothy Coulter, our national bishop, Dr. Franklin Ferguson, General Presbyter, Bishop Clayton Martin, our national youth director, Dr. Gandhi Thompson, all other bishops, ministers, and co-laborers of the gospel. I appreciate you and I greet you in the name of Jesus our Lord. It is only a matter of time. Dictionary defines time as the indefinite continued progress of existence and events in the past, present, and future, regarding them all as a whole. In order to have an appreciation for time, we have to begin to view every event in our lives, whether it be good or bad, as a part of a master plan. When it comes to the plan of God, there are no isolated circumstances for the believers. Everything that happens, whether it be good or bad, it happens in the context of the master plan. Jeremiah 29 and 11 says, I know the thoughts I think towards you, saith the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you an expected end. This tells us two things. One, though you may find yourself in an undesirable place, this is not a reflection of the thoughts of God towards you. Your current circumstances is not a reflection of your destiny, but rather it serves as a means to bring you to an expected end. It is a part of a process to get you to the place where God has designed for you to be. As believers, our experience in life will always fall within the context of a bigger picture. And so life is a summation of experiences, circumstances, happenings that serve as a catalyst for the will of God to manifest in our lives. As Paul profoundly puts it, he says, and we know that all things work together for good to those who love the Lord and are called according to his purpose. Emphasis on all things, whether they be good or bad. No matter what time it's happening or where it has happened, the Bible said that it all comes together and it works for our good. Most of the times it does not feel good, but it's working together for our good. And because God has a specific plan and purpose for every person and every place, no matter what undesirable state we find ourselves in, we should always expect things to change. Because as long as we have not arrived to the place that God has destined us to be, things are subject to change. With every negative or unfortunate circumstance, it is only a matter of time before change must come. As long as it is not in alignment with the will of God, we have not arrived to our expected end.
and circumstances are subject to change. You have to look at your life and look at the word of God and begin to compare the two. And if you find yourself in a predicament and in a place that you know that is not in alignment with the word of God or the word over your life, you can declare and deem that particular season of your life only for a short period of time. You can declare it to be an unacceptable place. I'm not accepting anything that is not in alignment with my destiny. I realize that I'm going through a hard time now, that my family may be experiencing some trouble. The church might look like we're going through some trouble at the moment, but we understand that if this present circumstance is not in alignment with where God says that he is taking us, we can declare it to be unacceptable. I may accept it in the moment because I understand that I got to go through it according to this particular period of my life. But I expect things to change. I expect that at some point in the matter, in the situation, something has to change. Time contributes to this arrangement by being the link between seasons, giving confirmation that something either has changed or it is about to change. Time is essential for comparison. The essence of change is rooted in the comparison of two seasons. Meaning it the essence and the thing that magnifies that change has happened is when you compare two separate seasons of your lives and you realize that in this season this particular thing was taking place, but now I am in a period where some things are beginning to change, and because of time you realize now that when I look at where I was and where I am now, there is a vast difference. There is a huge difference. And time has given the indication that I have entered into a new season. So God will allow a season to run its course for however long he sees fit. And when that season becomes full, he interrupts that season with a significant event that suggests to us that something is about to change. When a season, it is a woman, a season is like a woman who has come to the end of a 9-month period of pregnancy and the baby arrives and everything changes in our life. The things that she was used to before, she realized that she has to take on a new culture of life. Because now she has got to a period where a baby has been born. And now there is a significant contrast between this period now and the one that she was just in. It means that now the time has become full. And once time has become full, it has to produce what is called a Kairos moment. I want you to bear with me. I want you to bear with me tonight. It has entered into a period called a Kairos moment. After the 9 months of travailing and carrying this particular baby, then the time has come to give birth. This is known, according to scripture, as a Kairos moment, which is a defining moment in time or a divine event which suggests that we have entered a new season. The Bible refers to this divine moment as a set time or an appointed time, also known as a due season, or what we like to call God's timing. Habakkuk 2:2 says, "For the vision is for an appointed time. It hastens toward the goal and it will not fail. Though it tarries, wait for it will certainly come. It will not delay." I believe that when we talk about moments of delay, we talk about moments of delay out of our impatience. But let me advise you that when you have gotten to a place of a Kairos moment, there is no such thing as a delay. it may seem as though the period has been taking long for us to get to the place where we ought to have been. But there is no such thing as a delay. Why? Because when God has prepared to do something, there is no one or anything. There is no witch, warlock, or any seance or sorcery. There is no bad-minded person or anyone that wants to declare the opposite. There is nothing that can stop the will of God from happening when God says he wants it to happen. And so in the right time, there is no such thing as a delay in the moment. Galatians 4 and 7 puts it this way. It says, in the fullness of time, God sent forth his son born of a woman, born under the law to redeem those who were under the law so that we might have received adoption as son. Paul is saying that when time has reached its capacity, and all of the things that you would have gone through, the season, things are now into alignment. When time would have become full, God sent forth his son. Everything that happened between the time that Adam and Eve would have fell in the garden to the point that Mary conceived, whether it be good or bad in our eyes, it all contributed to the filling of time. With everything that had happened over the years, everything that the enemy would have done to stop the birth of Jesus and the coming of the Messiah, it doesn't matter what would have transpired. When time would have reached its capacity, there had to be some fulfillment of the word of God. What do I mean? I mean that on this journey, God will have us to go through some things to get us to the place where he needs us to be. It's not a delay. What it is a transition where God is dealing with us in a particular way that prepares us for the season that we are about to enter. It's not a delay. God is demonstrating the power of transformation in our lives so that particular our identity can become associated with the season that we're about to enter. When you have not arrived to the place that you think God has called you to be, it doesn't mean that God does not want you to get there. It simply means that we are not prepared for it. And time is running its course so that we can begin to prepare ourselves and take into consideration, what do I need to meet the requirements for what God wants to do in this season? I'm talking not just about an individual. I'm talking about families. I'm talking about in terms of our finances. I'm talking about the church. What is it that God has been trying to get into us so that we can be prepared to enter into this next season? If we are not to the place where God has called us to be, it means that there is still a little bit of tweaking. God still needs to deal with our identity. He's still trying to deal with some situation and matters. And once those things come to alignment with what God has promised, time would have reached its capacity. The pressure of time is now full with transformation. Our identity as a people and a church is now in alignment with where we need to be for God to do what he wants to do among us. And once time has come to its fullness, there's no stopping God. Can I tell you that the church, oh God, that the church is to a place where the capacity, Lord, slow me down, the capacity, there is pressure in the capacity, and we are at a place right now where time has reached its fulfillment, and a new season is upon us. A new era is upon us. A new season we are about to enter. Time has come full. We are about to enter a new season. Timing. Having made known to us the mystery of his will, that in the dispensation of the fullness of time, he will gather all things in one, both which are in heaven and which are in earth. Again, when time would have reached its capacity, a season full of circumstances, situations, trials, testing, warfare, persecution, despair, all that God would have used to cause us to enter into this season. When time would have reached its capacity, there would be an understanding of why these things had to be. When time would have come to its fullness, things would begin to make sense. In the middle of the circumstances, when the pressure is on the rise, you can't make sense of what's happening because you're in the middle of time. But when time had become full and all of the ingredients are in place, my attitude is now being fixed. I'm now changing my mindset and the way I'm treating people better. I'm learning how to forgive a little bit quicker. And now you understand, when time has come to its fulfillment, you'll be able to look back and begin to make sense of everything that you would have gone through. And so nothing is before its time, and nothing is after its time, but everything is always right on time. God is never late. He's always right on time, at the right time, in due season, at the set time, at the appointed time. God is always on time. Sometimes we look at situations and we say that, oh, this should have happened a long time ago. No, in your finite thinking, you feel like it should have happened a long time ago. But when it has happened, it is at the appropriate time. Time has reached its capacity. And when time has reached its capacity, the pressure causes us to enter into a new season. Timing. Bear with me. You would recall in John 7, thereabout, that Jesus would have been invited by his disciples to the Feast of the Tabernacle. And the Bible said that the Jews had been seeking to kill him, had sought to kill him. And so he said, you go ahead. Because he knew that if he went through that particular city, he would have met his demise. So he said, you go ahead. Why? Because my time has not come. There are still some things that I need to do. It is not time yet. Though my purpose is to die, the time for that has not come yet. There was still a little bit more room in the Chronos time for some things to happen before Cairo stepped in. There was Jesus had not even raised Lazarus from the dead yet. One of the miracles that was a defining miracle in his ministry in chapter 11, he said, give me a few more chapters and I'll be ready at the right time. And so we see him slowing things down because there was a process. You see him telling them, I don't want to go there yet because my time has not come. But then we see down in about John the 13th chapter, Jesus is talking to Judas. After the Bible said, and Satan had entered Judas. And Jesus is saying, he looked at him and he said, whatever you're going to do, I need you to do it quickly. Why? Because now time is full and reaching its capacity. And when time becomes full, it becomes an urgency in the spirit for some things to happen. Jesus Savior, and the Bible said that they did not understand why he asked Judas that, because they did not discern the time. But Jesus understood that there was something that needed to be done. And if I don't push this thing ahead, this thing is going to fall back. And so he said, Judas, I need you to betray me quickly, because purpose is at hand. The manifestation of the glory of God is at hand. I need you to get this thing going quickly. And so, church of the living God, there is an urgency in the spirit. I don't know who's feel this like me, but there is a rumbling in the spirit, and that God is saying that some things have to happen quickly. I had God saying I'm about to jump over some protocols to cause some things to happen quickly. There is an urgency in the spirit, not just because I'm declaring it, but the souls, the blood.
Men are being spilt on the streets every day, and it's like the heart of the church has waxed cold towards the decease of the sinful. But God is saying, I'm going to put pressure on this season. I'm about to apply pressure to the church. Everything that you've been going through, some of you wouldn't have been praying unless pressure was applied. And now God is saying, I'm at a point in my church where the pressure is becoming so full.
And it's producing an urgency in the spirit. Those who used to pray for 10 minutes are praying for 20 minutes. Those who are fasting half day are now fasting for a full day, because there is a pressure in the spirit. There is an urgency. There is no longer, no one is comfortable anymore with the bare minimum, because we realize that this is not business as usual. Oh God, I gotta get somewhere. For a second, help me, Jesus. There is an urgency. There is an urgency, people of God. There is an urgency, says the Lord, to the church. When the pressure is on to transition from one season to another, and you don't discern that now is the time, the only option is for the pressure to release from that particular season. Remember that the capacity is now full, so the pressure has to be released. So when the pressure is released to cross over into another season and you don't discern it, when the pressure is released, you begin to go in circles. Oh, Candidi Osha. You begin to go in circles. There's a stagnancy. You begin to wonder, because why? You didn't discern that there was a shift. You didn't discern that there was a transition. And we have not discerned that there was a transition. You know how I know? Because we are still operating as business as usual. I don't feel the urgency from the church of God. I don't feel the fire and the passion for lost souls from the church of God. But tonight, I have come as a man of God to step into this house to let you know that God is saying it is time for us to wake out of sleep. Not later or next week, but now is the time. The problem is why we're in this circle, because we miss defining moments in time. There are moments that God sent as a defining moment to let us know that the time is now to enter. And when we miss it, we begin to go around in circles. It causes a cycle. And the thing about it is, when you don't discern it and the cycle starts, you become immune to having no results. You become fine with having no results. You didn't meet the criteria to cross over, which was discernment, that there was an urgency. And so you begin to go around in circles, because the next best thing is to return to what's comfortable. But God is placing us in a seat of discomfort. He is messing around with our theology. He's causing what we... Oh, God, have mercy. Help me, Jesus. When you get to the transitional period, everything that was before is supposed to make sense. Behold, what manner of love the Lord has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. And the world does not know us. They cannot know us because they don't know him. The Bible said that when he shall appear, when we shall appear, when he shall appear, we will understand what God was trying to do with us. When the Lord appears, when he comes, it will begin to make sense, because it is a defining moment in time, discerning moments. Periods then there must be a transition. It's vital to the survival of a youth, of a young people. Discerning periods, then there must be a transition. It's vital to the survival of the church. Understanding in moments when things have to be done differently is vital to the survival of a legacy. Knowing when God is saying, I was there at some point, but I've already left there and I've gone this way. Discerning when it's time to move from that particular place to come over here. And somebody in their mind is telling me right now, but God said that he is the same yesterday, today and forever. Yes, that's God, but you are not the same. You are not the same. God is saying, you are, oh Lord have mercy. I gotta take my time with this. Discerning. What is discernment? It means that I'm not depending on what CNN says to guide where the church needs to be. I'm not depending on what social media is doing to influence what I do with my family and my money. It means that I have a connection with the Holy Ghost. I have a discernment, and the Lord is telling me that while everyone is frantic and believing that we are in such a great place of danger and trouble, he said, though you may be in trouble, what is more paramount is that you are in transition. And trouble and transition are synonymous. It is trouble that lets you know you are in transition. Unless trouble comes, some of you won't realize what God is doing. Every now and again, he put a little trouble in the mix. Sometimes we move in with no discernment. God said, I know how to get you here in me. I'm going to put a little trouble in the ingredients just to get you back on your face and to get us back on our knees. And so the church has entered a kairos moment. Please hear me. We've entered a moment, a defining moment. What a defining moment is, it is a moment in time where pivotal decisions must be made if we are to cross over. I don't want to seem as though I'm running away from the scripture and the theme for the conclave. But God is saying that part of the journey, I've already dealt with. We know what it is for the Lord to overthrow our enemies. This is the church of the living God. We've seen the Lord overthrow our enemies. We've seen what the Lord can do to demonic entities and principalities. We've seen how far the Lord has brought us from. And so this is not a fight where I'm teaching you about how to deal with Pharaoh's army. But this is a moment where I'm trying to get you to deal with yourselves. Because the fight has now shifted. And it's not no longer about spiritual warfare. But it is about warfare with our own mindsets. Help me. So we are at this pivotal moment in the body worldwide where decisions must be made at once. At once. What makes this easy to understand where we are now when we look at where the journey started? These people came to a place that God had been trying to get them to for a very long time. From the time he talked to Moses, he declared, he said, I am going to save my people and take them to a place filled and flowing with milk and honey. This was God's objective. This has been the goal from the onset. And so God began the journey and he began to put things in place. He began to put a strategy in place. For 400 years they had been under captivity, not understanding that God was about to shift things. Sometimes we end up into a place of bondage and we're not moving, and we begin to take it on as our portion. But God is saying, even that moment and
Egypt, before they got into a period of captivity, God said, even when things were good, he told them that it's only for a season. Before Joseph died, he said, I want you to know that the things wasn't always bad in Egypt. Before Joseph died, Joseph told him that the Lord is going to visit you. He said, yeah, the Lord is going to visit you. Do not bury my bones in this place, because this is only for a season. We do not belong here. It is so important when we realize where we do not belong. He said, don't even bury my bones here, because we do not belong here. But they didn't discern, and generations came. And the Bible said that there rose up a governor and a king who did not know Joseph. And so if he did not know Joseph, he didn't know Joseph's God. And now God is saying, it is time for me to begin to transition them. And so he begins to put strategies in place. This transition is not about a magical wand. It's not happening overnight. But you got to take note of the pieces, the piece of the puzzles that came together to get you to that place. Look what the Lord has done. The Bible said that when it was time for them to come out of Egypt, they began to grow in a way that was strange to the Egyptians. What I like about what God did, that when the Bible said that when the Hebrew mothers were given the assignment to kill the babies, the Bible said these women said, whenever we go to kill these babies, the mothers are giving birth before we get there, because God was on the move. And when God is doing a thing within the church and within our lives and in our families, there are things that are happening that we cannot stop. It doesn't matter what you're thinking. It doesn't matter what you're saying. It cannot be stopped. What God was about to do, it could not be stopped. Why? Because time has reached its capacity. Some of our time is 10 years. Theirs were 400 years. But time had reached its capacity. And now they're on the move. Now they're on the move. We've been on the move for a long time. Everything that has happened among us has served a purpose. All of the bad things, all of the good things, the things that you disagree with and the things that you agree with, it was all happening because we were in transition. And now God is saying, get moving. It is time for you to get moving. And then they crossed over. They finally got to the Red Sea, and they crossed over, and they got there down. They got over and crossed the Red Sea out of Egypt. And now the thing that they've been praying for, the transformation in the body, the thing that they have been praying for years, is finally upon them. But they couldn't discern it because they didn't look at the pieces that God was building in the beginning. Let me bring it home for you. If God is saying that you're going to be wealthy, you're going to have some struggles with money. If God is saying you're going to have money, you're going to have some struggles with money. If money is the area that God said he's going to bless you with, as soon as you get that prophecy, you better get on your knees, because your finances is about to be affected. Why? Because there's something that God wants to do to get you to the place where you could have your defining moment. And they got to this place, and it was time for them to go up. And the greatest tragedy happened. They finally got what they were fasting for. For 40 days they had viewed the land. For 40 days they had prayed. And they began to fight against the one thing that they have been praying for all of their lives, all of this period. But there stood a man among them who had to be bold. How many of you know it's not easy to stand before your own people and let them know what the Lord is saying? But Caleb stood before them and he said, at once. At once doesn't mean that we have time. Time is up. At once means it has to happen right now. God said it is time now for us to go up. This cannot just be a convention where we just want a quarter theme and have a good time and come back here next year for another theme. No, this is Kairos. And God is saying, warn the people that if we miss this opportunity, we're going to go into another season of cycles and wandering. But I came as a man of God to this house to declare that we shall not enter another cycle, but we shall go up at once and possess the land. When I look in the dictionary at what at once means, it means that we have to go up immediately, and it means everything and everyone at the same time. It means that even if we are afraid of what God is doing now among us, we still got to go up. Even if we are in fear, even if you don't understand what it is that God is doing, he didn't put a criteria on going up and say, you have to understand. He said, now is the time for you to go up. Whatever it is that God has been telling you to do, we have entered a moment in time where God said, you cannot miss this opportunity. Caleb, he began to sense that something was happening. He began to sense that something was about to stop them. And so he entered boldly in the moment. He said, let's go before this thing begins to spread in the camp. We gotta go now. It is time to go now. There are some of you in this house where God has been talking to you and bringing you to a defining moment. There are some of you right in here tonight where God has been speaking to you and you have missed some moments. But God is saying, not the prophet, God is saying, now is the time where it needs to be done. Don't miss this moment. Don't what God is about to do. Now is the time. Church, God, people of God, young people, we have entered a period where if you don't do it now, the struggle is about to be real. If you change it now, the struggle is to be real. Right now, if you have a matter that needs attending to, God is saying, don't wait until next week. Now is the time. Don't you understand that a portal is open over this sanctuary? That's what Kairos is. He has stepped out of heaven and declared this as an appointed time where some things has to happen. Now is the time.
The greatest enemy of our deliverance is not any demonic entity. For Jesus casted out devils in 10 seconds, and so should we. The greatest enemy of moving forward is not a demon or haters or warfare, any of those things. But the greatest enemy of our deliverance is our unwavering commitment to remain bound to the things that keep us bound. God said, there's no more waiting on me. I don't want to hear when God says. God said, now is the time for us to do what needs to be done. And yeah, the Lord said, in this next season for the church, no man shall get the glory for what I am about to do. Why? Because it is for the appointed time. When time is doing something, no man can get the glory for it. It is for the appointed time. Time is so powerful that even if we don't want to obey God, God will bring someone else to get it done. Why? Because it is the appointed time. No longer will we be committed to Egypt. A reoccurring theme and a place of comfort among a people that were poised for greatness. A reoccurring matter of just wanting to resort to the same thing. It was painful, but I was comfortable. It was ineffective, but I was comfortable. It yielded no results, but I was comfortable. Take me back to the place where I could labor
in bondage. I would rather go back instead of going forward. You're mad. If there's somebody in the house tonight, understand that this is a Kairos moment for you, for the body of Christ, for your situation. Kairos means anything that God wants to do now cannot be prohibited. Come forward. You cannot miss God right now, because this is the appointed time. You've been struggling with some things for some 15 years, but God is saying you will not miss me in this moment, because time has reached its fullness. Don't come if you don't need it. I'm not looking for the support. But if you understand that whatever you've been praying for years, that now is the time God has set for you. Come now. I want you to lift your hands. We're going to begin to pray. Caleb didn't need everyone to go up. He just needed 12 to agree that they should grow up. There are more than 12 at this altar. If you've been playing around with your soul and thinking you have time, if you miss this moment, deliverance is among us. Deliverance is upon us. I don't care what you've been struggling with. Now is the time that God is about to set some people free. Lift your hands and begin to pray. Begin to pray. Let us go up at once, right now. Begin to pray. If the Lord said it, He is able to do it. Let Him begin to move right now among you. I need everyone praying. I need everyone praying. There is a portal that's open, and heaven has set this moment for a divine. This is a divine moment, not be interrupted. Begin to pray. Open up your mouth and receive what it is that you need from the Lord. That's it. Ketanamandio. I know it's been a long time coming, but this is it. This is it. I want you to receive. There's nothing that can come, nothing can separate you from this moment. Nothing can separate you. Begin to move forward. Hey, Shia. Roshando de Bohosha. That's it. Hey, Commandio Shia. He did the Oshandi the Yoda de Bakushata. Yes, God. Yes, God. Hey, yes, sir. Open. Every mouth should be open. Every mouth should be open. He's breaking up the stoniness in our hearts. He's breaking up the stoniness. Something happens to us when we've been to the same place over and over and seem as though there's been no results. But when God has opened the Devakusha, when God has opened a period of time where He's about to do something, nothing can stop it. It's time. Feel
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We break the cycle. We break the cycle. We break the cycle. We break the repetition. We break the consistency of no results. We break the ceiling. Every glass ceiling. Every ceiling that is shy. Every ceiling that has kept you hindered for such a long time. Feel it. Feel the anointing. Feel the anointing. Open up your mouth. I need everybody to pray. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I believe that a healing anointing has just entered this room. If there's something in your body that you need corrected, you could run up to this altar and let God begin to deal with that thing. Let God, yes, sir, you got to be tired. You got to be tired. You got to be tired. Hey, you got to be tired. But there's a wind at your back. There's a wind at your back pushing you to the place where you need to be. Receive of the Lord. Oh, Randy Orka, he cut up under the bullshit. This is your moment. Moment. This is your moment in the name of Jesus. Yes, sir. Every hindrance must be removed. I came to enforce it. I came to enforce it. Every hindrance must be removed. I came to enforce it. I came to enforce it in the name of Jesus. I came to declare it. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir, you will never be the same again. You will never be the same again. You will, as I declare, that thing has come to an expiration in your life. That matter has met its expiration date. You will never be the same again. Somebody cry out. Somebody open your mouth. Cry out in this room. Cry out in this room. Cry out. Cry out in this room. Cry out in this room. Oh, Taya. Heramandi Osha. We'll be right back.
still working. He's still working. Say we give you all. He's still working in here. Yes, he's still working. You give me all the glory. Yes, God, we worship you. Oh, you're worthy. You're worthy. Come on. Come on, say we give you all. Walking, you're worthy to be praised. Come on, say we give you all, we give you all. Say we give you all. Everybody, we give you all. Yeah, yeah. He's still working in the room. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I want us to sing it one more time. You're worthy, you're worthy, you're worthy. Be too. Come on, say we give you all. I want you to break. Come on. I need everyone singing. Precious Father, we give you glory, we give you thanks, we give you honor, and we give you praise. Because we have been translated, we have transitioned into a place that may not make sense now, but we are trusting you, not by our own will, but because of your word. Father, I pray that you would cover this moment under the blood. That there be no hindrance to our progress as a people. Father, I pray that you would put a hedge of protection around this moment. For the enemy will seek to steal this moment with this and that and the other. But I pray today, oh God, that the blood of Jesus would seal this moment, and that your people, that no individual that sat in this room tonight will ever be the same again. I pray that you would seal this word over the families, that no family in this room would ever be the same again. I pray that you would seal this word over the church of God, a prophecy that we will never be the same again, that we will never resort, we will never resort to Mandi Oshaya, we will never resort to what we think we ought to be doing, but we will push forward and do what it is that you have called us to do. Let us be catapulted to a place so far into our destiny that the enemy will no longer be able to restrict us. Holy Father, be a wind at our back. Be the fire in the night. Be a wind and a light in the day. Be a light unto our feet. Be a lamp unto our path. We've tried everything and it has not worked. But God, we dedicate and commit ourselves unto your ways. Tonight, we dedicate and commit ourselves unto your way, unto your word. In the name of Jesus. We seal this moment.
under the internal blood of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Just want to thank all of you for coming out tonight and worshiping with us. We hope to see many of you back here in the morning. Sunday school begins at 9:30 a.m. and the service will start at 10:30. I want everyone to stand in the room tonight as we lift our hearts unto the Lord.
Thank you so very much. You've done such a wonderful job tonight, young people. Come on, let's praise the Lord for our young people. Let's bless the Lord for the leadership of Dr. Gandhi and those wonderful, that cadre of youth leaders who have led our young people throughout the year. God bless you all and our moderators today. This evening, you've done a remarkable job. We thank the Lord for you. Again, we want to remind you that 6 a.m. tomorrow morning, there is prayer meeting in this place. We need you. We really need you, young people, to come and let's converge here and pray. God bless you, Minister Christopher. What a wonderful word tonight. Have you been blessed? Have you been encouraged by the word of God? Amen, amen. And as you've heard it said tonight in the message, the church is in good hands. It is in God's hand, and God has an army of young people who are motivated and ready to work to do what God has called us to do and to be. And so again, for those district overseers or supervisors who have not gotten your meal tickets, see Sister Val tomorrow morning, just if you're on my left, and get your tickets. We don't want anyone who has come from the islands to go unfed. You should not have to pay for your lunch tomorrow because it's been provided for by the convention. God bless you again tonight, and all who have come, who came visiting with us tonight, please be upstanding. Everyone stand now, we're getting ready to go. And we thank you. We see a number of our new bishops in the place. God bless you, Bishop Stephen, Bishop Barry. Who else I saw tonight? Bishop Stewart. Who else? God bless all of our bishops. God bless you. We love you all, and we appreciate you, this wonderful group of young people from the islands, from Grand Bahama, from New Providence. Man, you have made us all feel very, very good tonight. We are encouraged because the future of this church looks very, very good. God bless you all. Now, let's stand, please. Let's stand, and we pray for tomorrow's session. Pray for our women. We pray for everything that's going to take place. Our final service will be tomorrow evening. And we want all of you to participate in the parade. Now, you may not be able to march from this tabernacle to the Western Esplanade, but you can pick us up somewhere along the way, and you can participate and have a wonderful time. Let's bow. Father, we thank you. Great is your faithfulness. We thank you for this service tonight, Lord. Thank you for Dr. Gandhi. Thank you for Minister Christopher. Thank you, Lord, for all of your young people. Thank you for the leadership of youth ministries throughout the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. We just bless you tonight, Lord, and we pray that you will keep and preserve their integrity, their character, their testimony, that even as they go through, they'd understand that this is a Kairos moment when you divinely intervene into the affairs of mankind and you make a difference. Help us to understand the immediacy of the moment and to urgently respond to what the Spirit is saying to us tonight. We thank you, Lord, for those who've joined us from the virtual environment. We pray that all of us will be transformed because of this encounter with God tonight. And now, Father, as we prepare to leave this place, this space, but not your presence, we say grace, mercy, and peace. The blessings of God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with us all now and forevermore. And the youth of the church and all others say amen, amen. God bless you. Have a safe night. 6 a.m. tomorrow by the grace of God. God bless you, Bishop Frank. God bless you, Dr. Rowe. God bless our presiding bishop.